share the evening with us and his experiences. Please welcome Martin Campbell with Deities That Challenge Mainstream Concepts of Spirituality and Sexuality. Thank you.
I thought I'd give you a round of applause for turning up. It's very kind of you, I wasn't expecting that. So I'm just going to start off. My God is beside me. I'm just kind of a little moment with him. And I'd ask you just to think about the concept of a gay God, because that's where I'm going to talk tonight. I'm Martin Campbell. I share my life and my love with my lovely Soma, who's sitting on the end, which makes me a very gay man in both senses of the word. So I'm an author. I've published my book here, which is my first novel. It was published in 2014. I'm aiming to write a series of novels about the non-heterosexual history that none of us, or few of us, are ever taught or find. I want to help you to know where to look, and it's kind of my job this evening. So the first question, I guess, is what do you guys know about deities that challenge the mainstream concepts of spirituality and sexuality? It's not a subject very often talked about, is it? So some of us know a lot, some know a little, or some of us know none. I'm 51, I lived 40 years of my life knowing absolutely nothing about these things, despite growing up as a gay man came out when I was 19. So we're all learning, we're all on a path, whether you're heterosexual or non-heterosexual. So my job is to try and enlighten you about some of these things that are kind of often buried. Happy to take questions at the end, or if you've got a really burning question in the middle, then do shout at me. If you're this side of me, I'm blind to my left, so I can't see, so shout at me if you want to get a question. I've done handouts of pretty much everything I'm going to show you tonight, which are over on the desk there. Feel free to take them. There's sort of information, there's websites at the end and so on if you find those helpful. So firstly, why do this now? I'm not just doing this now arbitrarily. There are reasons that I've chosen to do it now. And I thought I'd just give you a little run through of history that's led up to this, which will help you understand why I'm doing it now. So back in 1533, the word buggery was first put into law. And I said word I never thought I'd say in public, but they go buggery. And it was considered such a serious offence that it was a capital punishment if you were proven to have sex with a man. And that lasted until the 19th century. And then in 1885, it was enshrined into law to ensure that you could prosecute someone who was accused of buggery, which is marvellous. So carrying on from that, that carried right through on until 1967, when the Sexual Offences Act decriminalised homosexuality. Although you had to be 21 to be allowed to have a partner. Thankfully, 2001, the Sexual Offences Act was updated, and for the first time in British history, there was then equality between gay people and straight people. So that was quite a major thing. So suddenly everybody at 16 was then allowed to be in a relationship, although arbitrarily in Northern Ireland it was 17. I don't know why I should have said something. There we go. However, despite that positivity, previous convictions for offences did stay in place. And then just this year, in January, something rather marvellous happened, and that's the Alan Turing section of the Policing and Crime Bill. And that, for the first time, pardoned 49,000 plus men who had been convicted under the previous sexual offences laws. It's hard to take that in, isn't it? 49,000 people. Most of them, sadly, long dead. It was called the Alan Turing Law. I don't know if people know of Alan Turing, but he's a great hero of mine. He was the code breaker in the Second World War that led the team helping to break the Enigma code, which was the encoded messages that the Germans could send to their U-boats and their submarines and ships and so on. He and his team managed to break that code. In doing so, it's thought that he shortened the war by roughly a year, possibly more, and certainly saved millions of lives. So he should be an international hero, shouldn't he? There should be statues everywhere to him. He should be considered one of the greats of the world. He pretty much invented the computer to do the breaking of the code. So, you know, there should be statues to him in Silicon Valley. That, you know, all of that should be in place. But no. In 1952, he was caught with another man and was threatened. He was found guilty, threatened with prison. And I think he knew, as well as most gay men in that situation would know, that if you go to prison, you are going to have one hell of a time. So he was offered chemical castration, which basically means that he's injected with oestrogen. And gradually grew breasts and his voice started to change. And he, understandably, couldn't deal with that. So he committed suicide. So one of the greatest British men, one of the great heroes, I think, of the world, was forced into suicide in 1952. And that still resonates with me as one of the most shocking things that humanity has ever done. And indeed, in my faith, he is a saint. In 2013, at long last, 59 years later, he was pardoned. Not such good news. In January this year, marvellous Mr. Trump came to be the president of America, and within a day of him coming into the presidency, his staff removed any references to gay, lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender rights, just wiped off, which makes you think about what might be to come. However, on a very much more positive note, it is 50 years since the Sexual Offences Act allowed homosexuality to be legal. And rather marvellously, there's going to be national celebrations about it, which is, I think, fantastic. All over the place where the gay communities are and where there is clear lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender history in any of those places. So places like National Trust properties, the British Museum and other museums are going to celebrate this very openly, very publicly. And for some of those museums, that's kind of a first. So it's quite a major, big deal. And the Oscars has just happened. You may have seen some of the debacle about actually saying which was the best film. But the best film did win, and that was Moonlight, which is a film about a black gay man. So for the Oscars to acknowledge a black man, a gay man, quite a major, major shift in thinking, and a bit of a thumb to the nose for Donald Trump as well. So really, for me to do this tonight, I don't think there's a better time. It's kind of spot on. Now, I'm going to take you through a load of definitions. I'm just going to chat to Lady in the front here. I think it is quite important, because some of you may not know them. Some of you might know them, but might not know them in the way that I am thinking about them. And this is mostly for me tonight to help you understand what it is I'm going to tell you. So I hope I don't bore you. I'll wake you up in a few minutes if I do. So, first of all, I've used the word God. And what immediately springs to mind for most people around that is a male being with divine purpose. a being who's made to control our fate, and his sexuality is never mentioned. Is he straight? Is he gay? It doesn't matter. A lot of worshippers of God would automatically assume that he is heterosexual. Goddess, of course, there are many goddesses too. They're not as worshipped these days. It's harder to find them unless you live in Glastonbury. The many women locally worship the goddess El-gabal. I've never heard it discussed what her sexuality is. Do I know? Who knows? My concept of God is a non-gender specific energy. I call it the source from which all other gods and spirits derive. I think they are the kind of conduit for us between that infinite energy and our physical placement on Earth. You'll all have many different definitions. Feel free to use your own other gods and goddesses. We can all argue it for hours, I'm sure. So do gods and goddesses need to have a specified sexuality? Well, of course, in an ideal world, no. It made no difference at all, would it? I'm Martin, an author in love with my lovely Samia. I'm not gay Martin. Sadly, there is not an ideal world, as we all know. In the name of God's, some people of faith are persecuting the likes of Samia and I. So accessing God or Goddess with an openness to sexualities becomes really, really important. Religion. My shorthand for this is monotheistic, a bit of a mouthful, isn't it? One God only, structured pan-national faiths with clear written doctrine, socially accepted norms of behaviour and often significant political power. And that's why people from my community often struggle with them. Now, I'm using pagan in a very broad sense, and I know people might argue with me about this, but it's my shorthand for this evening, saying that they are equally pan-national faiths. They're philosophical philosophical systems, but they're not typically monotheistic. They're not typically structured. They're not typically very well-organised faiths, although people would argue with that. A lot of them don't have clearly written doctrine, and some do or some don't have socially accepted norms of behaviour, and neither do they have political power. I think that's one of the key differences, why it's sometimes easier, I think, to access faith that are not in the mainstream. So, other gods and goddesses. Across the world's faith, there are countless deities, sub-deities, spirits, etc. They typically are described as having one source, God, whatever, further back, as I've described previously, although not always. But throughout human history, most cultures worship these deities rather than one God. And tonight, that's what I'm talking about. I'm talking about those broader range of gods and goddesses. And as I said before, I think they're the conduits between us and the ultimate source of creation. Gay, that wonderful word that people define Samia and I as, basically started off as a term of abuse. In the early 20th century, it referred to the concept that all gay men were perceived to be feminine, superficial and happy. You get the whole limp thing, and all that other horrible nonsense that came with it. So you meant to put on a gay face. In the 1970s, things started to change. There were Stonewall riots in the late 60s, 70s, and the gay community began to claim that word back and actually use it back at the bigots, which is quite an important thing. It's the same as with the black community, claiming back the word black and saying, okay, we've got the black community. And we did the same thing, okay, we're the gay community. But over time, it started to have slightly different uses. It became a bit of a catch-all for the lesbian, gay, bisexual and transgender community, which isn't strictly right, and I'll come on to explain that. And then more recently, of course, it started to be used again as a kind of a term of something being rubbish or non-masculine. You hear a lot of kids using it, and it's a shame. teachers, parents and so on need to really try and counter that, because it's so frustrating to see that coming back into fashion. So other, we'll use the acronym LGBT, you may have heard it, and basically the community uses that acronym, as do professionals, so I'm going to use it. So the L stands for lesbian, which is a woman who has sex or loving relationships only with women. Gay is a gay man who has loving relationships or sex only with men. B is for bisexual, someone who would have sexual loving relationships with either. And transgender or trans. Now it's important at this point to stress that trans is not a sexuality. It's not to be confused with transvestites. Being trans is a gender issue only. Trans people feel they've been born into the wrong bodies and wish to live as the opposite gender. And some will have corrective surgeries to do so. And it's useful to understand that at that point, regardless which body they're in, they can then be straight, lesbian or bisexual. And I've met many people that fall into all those categories. They tend to get kind of grouped in with the LGB community because they face similar kinds of discrimination and problems in society. So they tend to kind of end up in gay or lesbian bars, etc., because there's a sense of safety there, but it isn't always the case. And I've seen gay people be really, really horrible to trans people. So it's not always as clear-cut as you might think. So other definitions, sorry this is going on a bit, but I think it's important to draw the line in the sand a little bit. So straight heterosexual is a person who has a sexual or loving relationship with people of either gender, obviously. Homosexual, and that's a clinical word. People often use it thinking it's quite a friendly word, but it's not. It's a very clinical word, first used in the late 19th century. Originally just referring to men who had sex with men, but later on it became a broader use of for men or women that had sex with their own gender. Sodomites, that lovely word, again started as a term of abuse, and is a biblical reference to the sinful city of Sodom, where apparently there were many homosexuals, which sounds lovely to me, but God destroyed it. Homophobic, there are sadly lots of these people around. They're people who cannot bear to be in contact with people like Sam and I because of religion, fear, or simple hatred. Sadly, it's mostly the last one. Last of my definitions, you'll be thanking the gods. Asexual, a person who chooses not to have sex with either gender, but may still form loving relationships with people of either gender. Now, as I said, there's a handout over on the desk there, which I give a load more definitions in, things like transvestite, queer, genderqueer, intersex, hermaphrodite, and several others. So if you're interested in some of that, it's all there. So please do that. I won't cover it now because I could go on for hours, which would bore you. So, can an LGBT person worship a god or a goddess? Well, of course, yes. Anybody can worship any goddess or god or goddess they like. However, can an LGBT person really worship those gods or goddesses? Or, a better question, do the people in control of the doctrine of these religions allow LGBT people to openly worship their gods and goddesses? In addition, do the worshippers of those religions also allow such a thing? It's very rare that either do. If they do, it's usually toleration, and you kind of hear things like, as long as you don't flaunt it, as long as you don't talk about it, or just pretend you're normal, or dress normally, try to blend in, or you can't marry here. And now, of course, if you're in the US, you're now told that you can't use the toilets if you're a trans person. You have to go in the one that is your original gender. Horrific. And if you're a spiritual person, it's all terribly disheartening, and you kind of start to lose faith, not just in faith, but in humanity as a whole. A little update, in terms of faith in the UK, the Church of England House of Bishops has just published a new report following 2 years of internal discussion. and it declared that there is little support for changing the church's teaching on marriage, i.e. it's between one man and one woman. Indeed, the Right Reverend Graham James, Bishop of Norwich, said at a press conference that the church should not adapt its doctrines for the fashions of any particular time. The Southern Irish fashion, I don't think really. Not even fashion. However, the report does go on to say that the church should adopt a fresh tone and culture of welcoming, of being welcome and support. Very nice of them. So, what do you do if you are LGBT, but you know you're spiritual and feel drawn to faith? Most LGBT people grow up assuming, hearing and seeing that religion and or spirituality is not for them. Saying it again, and again might be controversial, but an example might be paganism, where the images you see are all focused on very masculine images of men or very feminine images of women, all as a part of a cycle of fertility. So coming up like that as someone's LGBT is slightly more difficult to access. Or you might feel that it's not something you can access. Some of the ways that religions depict right or sing their faith are unintentionally exclusive, but nonetheless, they are exclusive. So LGBT people just get on with life, they deny the spiritual aspect of themselves, and they often turn to overt materialism, anarchy, promiscuity, substance misuse. They just get lost in society. Many homeless people you will see on the streets are LGBT. Many end up with chronic mental health problems or take their own lives. I came close. It's quite close to the hearts of these things. I grew up in very conservative Buckinghamshire throughout the 60s, 70s and 80s. For most of that time, Christianity was spirituality. Few ever questioned it, and I learned to fear God. My heterosexual friends, and I did have many, were mostly already finding sexual and romantic relationships, which is all lovely, and you're looking on that from the outside and think, when can that happen for me? So I took a deep breath and said, okay, I'm going to change my life, and I moved to Brighton to join the hedonistic student life there. It was great fun, absolutely loved it. But it was the 1980s, and the forces of hate began closing in. Margaret Thatcher's police force took photos of gay people on gay pride marches. We never knew why, but they were there, clicking away at us, full uniform cameras. Age 21, I had my first relationship with a guy. He was 19. In doing so, I broke the law. Indeed, one evening, walking in town, holding hands with my lovely partner at the time, a police car drew up beside us and drove at walking speed beside us, and again, the police were taking photos. I would love to know where those photos ended up. Great mystery to me, but it was all intimidation. It was designed to make us feel uncomfortable, make us feel like they were watching us, which indeed they were. And of course, nationally, threats were being made about rounding up people I knew with AIDS. And all of this was done with some kind of crazy Christian undertone to it. I'm sure Margaret Thatcher thought she was doing good for society from a Christian basis. And at the time I read the Bible, I had a look in the Quran, and I knew very clearly that nationally I was considered, and faith were telling me that I was a sinner, and I knew I was at risk. So spirituality was needed, but politics and resisted was needed much more at that time. So what did I do? Well, before I planned anything, I had a successful career, a romantic and social life, and my life was full. But I also felt partly empty. I'd given up on faith. I'd stopped looking or trying. And I was drifting. Then, I took holiday in Rome. And I found Antinous. Or some people argue with me that he found me. And genderless can be pronounced in many different ways. I've heard it pronounced in many different ways, and it really doesn't matter. So you hear, I say Antinous, others say Antinous, others say Antinous. Doesn't matter, pronounce it any way you like. He was born in Turkey, he lived in Egypt, he lived in Rome. They would have always said it in different ways. Doesn't matter. Every great museum in Rome had fabulous statues and busts of Antinous, as do many museums globally. Everyone I looked at in Rome had a little ticket under it just saying, the favourite of Hadrian. So I was walking around those museums thinking, what do I mean? So I then started to look into it. And the most amazing fact I found, I still think it's one of the most amazing facts, is that there are more images surviving of Antinous from the ancient world than any other ancient person. Including people like Julius Caesar, Cleopatra, there are more images of Antinous than any of them. Yet do you know who he is or what? Antinous black faces, I guess not. This is Antinous. This is a colossal statue in the Vatican. It was found in the centre of Rome. It's huge. That's me beside it. Anybody recognise? This is Antinous. Recognise it? That's an image of Antinous tattooed onto the torso of Adam Lambert, obviously. Because of him, Antinous is getting a huge new following in Canada and America. Adam's from Canada. Huge sudden following, thousands of his followers all interested in Antinous, which is amazing just because he tattooed himself. But don't worry if you don't recognise him. You're not alone. Most people don't. So who is he? Very brief synopsis. As I said earlier, he was born in Turkey, but that was then part of Greece, and it was under Roman rule. We know nothing about his family background, or indeed his status in society, really. Travelling through, the Roman Emperor Hadrian met him, fell in love with him, and then made him his consort, so he travelled with him as his partner, despite having a wife, the Empress Sabina. She, however, was a lesbian. So it was a marriage of convenience. She was a much higher status person in that society, so by marrying her, he was lifted up and could therefore be emperor. Hadrian and Antinous travelled around the ancient Roman world. Indeed, they spent most of Hadrian's time as emperor, travelling the ancient world, the Roman world. However, whilst they were travelling abroad, Rome was really struggling. The main problem being that there was a huge famine in Egypt, and Rome relied on the grain from Egypt to make its bread. So Rome was starving, and Hadrian's rule was becoming questioned. Then, tragically, Antinous, my god, drowned in the Nile, aged approximately 21. There's no certainty about the death. Was he pushed, murdered, sacrificed? Was it an accident? Did he jump? There's no record to know certainly how he died. His tomb is yet to be discovered. I put that, and then 2 or 3 days ago, it looks like there could be a tomb about to be discovered, so I'm keeping all my fingers crossed. So he drowned. So what? Drowning in the Nile meant that he became associated with the Egyptian god Osiris. And what that would do for anybody who drowned in the Nile at that time, you were meant to then bring great luck and joy to your family and your loved ones. And I believe that Antinous deliberately committed suicide in the Nile for that reason. He knew that Hadrian's rule was rocky, and I think he felt that he would bring luck to Hadrian by dying. And indeed, within days, the rains came, the crops grew, the Roman Empire was fed, and Hadrian's rule was saved. At the same time, a star appeared in the sky, which sounds quite biblical, doesn't it? But there are ancient Chinese records that record that there was a supernova that year, and that's what Hadrian spotted. And he proclaimed that it was Antinous reborn in the sky. And that star, still called Antinous, is still up there, still shining down on us. You'll find it in the constellation of Ganymede. On the curve of the North Atlantic, I was drowned. Hadrian built a Roman city. There were only two ever built in Egypt. His was the second. And it was the home of some very early Christian saints. And sadly, it's now a ruin, but that's where they may have just found his tomb. So I'm keeping all my fingers crossed. So the most important aspect of this story is that Hadrian felt that Antinous had saved him, as I believe, and it saved Rome. So he declared that Antinous was a god, a gay god, and that's a really significant first, really. So what does that mean? And there's a lot of discussion about this internationally, about can you describe Antinous as a gay god? A lot of people say no. Even gay theologians often say no, because in ancient Rome, the word gay didn't exist. The concept, a lot of people think, didn't exist. If you were a man, as long as you were dominant in a relationship, be that with a woman, with a guy, you were dominant, that was fine. You were just a man, that was okay. If you were not dominant, then there was a problem. Dominant men were meant to only have sex with young men that didn't have a beard, couldn't grow a beard. So it was, in our perspective, that's slightly dodgy, but that's how it was in that society. So a lot of people say, well, he couldn't have been gay, then there wasn't that word gay. But in the ancient Greek and Roman world, there was the term Sinaidus. He was a character in an ancient Greek play who was quite feminine and theatrical. So that word was used. So if you can say he was a Sinaidus god, then why can't you say he's a gay god? Anyway, what next? Hadrian's rule ended with him decreeing the next four emperors that would follow him. And that was carried out, that the emperors did succeed and allow his dynasty to carry on, and it became known as the Antonine dynasty. And it ruled over the most stable period in Rome. People often refer to it as the golden era of Rome. And a lot of the intellectual, artistic thinking of that time influenced the modern world. We wouldn't be here without Antinous. And yet none of you knew his name. And it's interesting to know also that the cult of Antinous was as big as the early cult of Jesus. In fact, the two cults grew side by side for hundreds of years. There were temples to Antinous all over the Roman Empire. But what happened next? Christianity grew faster. And then, in AD 313, the Roman Emperor Constantine converted to Christianity, as did most emperors that followed him. Then came the Emperor Theodosius III, and he is something I hate. He brought in the Christian persecution of the pagan faiths. In AD 381, the persecution began. Temples were destroyed and pagans were massacred all over the empire. Antinous temples and worshippers probably suffered most under that Christian repression, because a gay faith cannot be tolerated, could not be tolerated. It's interesting that archaeologists can dig up pagan temples all over the world, but they cannot find, where they know there should be, they cannot find temples to Antinous. The Christians remove even their foundations. So who cared? Well, obviously the Antinous worshippers did at the time, and they very, very carefully buried Antinous images all over the empire, which is why all those hundreds and hundreds of images survive. There were beautiful statues that were lowered onto gravel in the soil and buried, so they were perfectly preserved. But then no one cared for 1500 years. When people began finding all those carefully buried statues, and popes and nobles of Italy went crazy for them. There was Antinous mania over actually the whole of Europe. Everybody that could wanted one of the statues or the busts of Antinous. They became massive collectors of items. People paid huge sums of money to get their hands on one of them. And who cares now? Well, a growing number of people like me began to discover the story. And in the 1990s, in Los Angeles, of all places, a young gay man called Antonius Subia founded the revived cult of Antinous. The Antinouian faith emerged. It's an LGBT faith. There are now thousands of LGBT people internationally finding him, realising they're not alone. It's such a relief when you do. There are worshippers in North and South America, Europe, Asia, and even, we just found out, Mongolia. There's some guy in Mongolia who's looking at websites and finding, it's fantastic. Respect for straight people are very welcome. It's an open thing. I'm the first UK Antinomian priest, which is a bit of a kind of scary thing, and this is my first step into that, really. So what was my journey to that point? So as soon as I knew and researched the story of Antinous, I knew I had found my God. And that was such a huge revelation and joy, I can't begin to describe to you how that felt, to know there was a God for me, and I had found him, and I found a whole load of other worshippers. The relief, the absolute relief, is really hard to describe. Initially I'd googled him, as we all would, I hope you're all going to rush off and do it yourselves, and found the Hollywood Temple, which is what Antonio Silvio had founded. I began to meet companions, as we describe ourselves, my Antinous, all over the world, and I've made some really important, significant friends through doing that. And I decided I'd write a novel. I was very blessed to get it published. But on that journey, I'm clairaudient, I can hear spirits. And I was at the British Museum pondering the book. And there's a wonderful statue there of Hadrian as a priest. And as I was walking past that statue, I heard very clearly, write the novel. I mean, in a very imperial kind of way. So I realised I had to do it. I travelled to Italy, Greece, and Egypt and did the research, which I loved. But then I found it hard to find the time to do any more. I had a full-time job, see the management job in the NHS, and I'm only going to find the time. But then the gods found the time for me. In 2012, I had a terrible stroke, a bleed onto my brain, and I died. Just looking at my partner there because he's saved my life. I had extensive physical and neurological rehabilitation, and at the end, I was signed off work for a year. And the clinician said to me, "Do you have anything you can do that can keep your brain stimulated?" And I said, "Yes." So for the next year, I wrote my novel. The process helped to rebuild my brain. I genuinely feel I was saved by Antinous, other than one of them. So my novel, The Love Club, was published in 2014, and I've had excellent ongoing reviews, which is marvellous. And it felt like a very long act of worship, and I still consider it my greatest act of worship. So in 2014, the existing priests of Antinous asked if I would join them as the first priest of the UK. And after much deliberation, because I had to think it through with my health, and I'm still quite vulnerable, we talked about it, and I said yes. And I was ordained in the Petrie Museum in London, which is a wonderful place to be ordained because you're surrounded by this fantastic collection of Egyptian antiquities. And I'm just beginning to sort of think about my ministry and how to do it. This is one of the first big steps for me. As I say, my health is quite vulnerable, but I feel very well, physically I feel very well. And it seems odd sometimes, doesn't it? Because I know I've got all these disabilities, but I actually physically feel well. And last year I found out why. During my crystal therapy, as I said, I think I said earlier on, I'm a crystal therapist, I noticed that my tutor's husband was really staring at me intently, which was slightly unnerving. Why is he doing that? I was thinking, I've got a bogey on my nose. And in the coffee break, he took me aside and said to me, he's a shaman and intuitive, but he said to me, "But look at you, you're surrounded by seven spirits." Okay, and he said, "And then there's an eighth one at the side." And suddenly it clicked with me. I was like, "Oh my God, my jaw hit the floor." You see, Hadrian was, of course, the first priest, the pontifex of the faith of Antinous. There is then archaeological evidence that he ordained seven priests to set up the first Antinous temples across the Roman Empire. They were all protecting my health. They were standing around me. I was ordained in the name of the priest who set up the ancient Antinous temple of Delphi, one of my favourite places in the world. And he was called Aristotimus. So my priestly name is Martinus Aristotimus. So good luck. So, are there any other LGBT deities? Oh, yes. Mostly ancient Roman or Greek, but I think what's perhaps more interesting is all across the Arab world, where we now know such terrible things are happening, there were a range of LGBT deities. There are LGBT-friendly deities, there's a gay saint in South America, and there's this wonderful gay rabbit deity in China, and I'm not joking about that. First of all, there's the Radical Fairy Collective, and I don't know about this in detail. I know that many LGBT people feel drawn to worship a range of pagan deities. Saint Numis is one that a lot of gay men are drawn to. And there are excellent groups out there. But the thing that I have discussions with people about is that the gods and goddesses that they are looking to worship are not specifically LGBT or T. Jesus. Now that might surprise you that I'm putting this on here. But if you think about it, he was a Jew who never said anything negative about being LGBT. He preached peace and love for all, whoever they were. He appears to have been asexual, never married, although some do it later. He travelled Judea with 12 adoring men and a prostitute. But no, I don't think Jesus was gay, nor probably his disciples. But their fight was with a Roman and Jewish hierarchy that denied the people of Judea any rights. Therefore, I don't think he would be homophobic. So LGBT people should be able to worship him. And indeed, there are Jewish and Christian organisations which do welcome LGBT people. We want to stress they're there. So there's Reform Judaism, the Quakers, and the Unitarian Church. They're not mainstream, but at least they exist. So therefore, I think Jesus is an LGBT-friendly God. People will probably argue with me, that's some of you. Saint El Nino Fidencio, and I probably pronounced that wrong, people may tell me. He was a Mexican curandero, which is a male witch healer or shaman. In the 1920s and 30s, he rather marvellously depicted himself in drag as the Virgin Mary, which I suspect the Catholic Church were not particularly thrilled about. But he's regarded as a saint by thousands of people across South America in particular. And many of them say that he's done innumerable miracles and so on. So he is worshipped, he's held esteemed by thousands and thousands of people across South America. Heard of him? Agni, the Hindu god of fire. Agni is the Hindu god of fire, wealth, creative energy, and he has same-sex sexual encounters that involve accepting semen from other gods. Has a significant same-sex relationship with Soma, the god of the moon. That's a gay god. My hero, the Emperor Hadrian. At the major British Museum exhibition, Hadrian, Empire and Conflict in 2009, the curator of that exhibition, Thurston Opper, stated that Hadrian was gay. That was the first time that had ever been acknowledged by any museum anywhere in the world. when Hadrian died in AD 138, his successor, Antoninus Pius, had Hadrian deified as a god. So he's a gay god. Greek and Roman god Heracles, or Hercules. Hercules is famous for his strength and his great adventures. His principal lover was a male youth called Hylas. Hylas was abducted by a water nymph and never seen again, I think that's true. But Hercules, bless him, searched forever trying to find his Hylas, and he called her Hylas, which is where we got our phrase alas, alas. He's a gay god. Other gay gods. Zeus, the principal god of the Greeks, his great love of his life was the male youth Ganymede. Achilles, the great warrior of ancient Greece, his great love was the young man Patroclus. And here he is, the Chinese gay god who's depicted as a baby hare or rabbit. He does exist, he really does. And his name is Tuo Shen, who's the leveret spirit, or the baby hare spirit, or Chu Shen, the rabbit god. He's the deity who manages the love and sex between LGBT people. And he is worshipped right now. There are thousands of Chinese people that worship him. You heard? Julius Caesar. I bet some of you are kind of what we're talking about, because you know, he's that great strong Roman emperor who's the love of Cleopatra. But after his assassination, he was deified as a god. And as a young man, he was the lover of a Greek king called Nicomedes IV. There are few books that ever mention that, but it is there in ancient Roman texts. I've read them, and it's the subject of my next novel. Hold your weight in breath for that. So he's a bisexual god. The Roman empress and goddess Sabina. Roman sources speak of Sabina as being a lesbian. Indeed, we know her lover's name was Julia Balbilla, who was a renowned poet at the time. On Sabina's death, Hadrian had her deified as a goddess, and in short, images of her, just like Antinous, were set all around the empire. So she is a lesbian goddess. The goddess Artemis, or Diana. In Greek mythology, she is Artemis. For the Romans, she was Diana. She was goddess of the hunt, archery, wild animals, and chastity. And she's rumoured to have been the lover of Athena or Minerva, sort of Greek-Roman aspects of the same goddess. Minerva is also perceived to be a virgin, never been linked to a man. So Artemis and Diana, and potentially Minerva, are lesbian goddesses. The goddess Atargatis, she is a female deity worshipped in what is now Aleppo in Syria. So sadly, a lot of the archaeology there is not gone. During the Roman era, the young males castrated themselves to become transgender deities at the temple, thereafter performing temple tasks traditionally done by women in the temple, thus a goddess worshipped by trans people. The Egyptian deity Hapi, great name, was the god of the annual flooding of the River Nile, fish, birds, and Lord of the river bringing vegetation. It was the goddess that was worshipped every year. The Nile became inundated with water, and they would measure the height of the Nile every year with the goddess or god Hapi standing there. Hapi is depicted as a transgender deity with a large belly, pendulous breasts, and wearing a loincloth and the ceremonial false beard of the pharaohs. So, transgender deity. There are gender-fluid Hindu deities. Many of the Hindu deities do kind of flow between different genders. So there's Adana Harvisara, who was created by the merging of Shiva and Parvati. And the name means the Lord who is half a woman. The god Vishnu took the form of the enchantress Marnie to trick the demons into giving up the elixir of life, wouldn't we all like that? Thus, transgender deities. And the gods El-gabal and El-gabalus. An ancient city called Emesa, now tragically Homs in modern Syria, virtually destroyed in the recent conflict. There's a cult to a genderless deity called El-gabal. The main temple was built around a large stone, probably, we think, a meteorite. There was a Roman emperor called Marcus Aurelius Antoninus. He was born in Emesa. And when he became emperor as a teenager, very young teenager, he renamed himself El-gabalus. And he had himself castrated so that he could better emulate his god, to be a genderless god. And he lived then and dressed as a woman. So he was a transgender emperor and the incarnation of a god. So a trans god. Any of you heard? So why does all this matter? Well, in recorded history we know for the last 700 years at least, that's kind of where we know it's recorded for 700 years, LGBT people have been deliberately and specifically persecuted for being themselves. Hundreds, possibly thousands of sodomites or buggers were burned at the stake in the Middle Ages. Homosexuality was a hannibal offence in most European countries until the late 1800s. In the 1930s, Germany, the Nazis arrested approximately 100,000 men and forced them to wear pink triangles on their very proudly. Roughly 50,000 of those men were officially sentenced. Most of them spent their time in ordinary prisons, but 15,000 poor souls were incarcerated in the Nazi concentration camps, and very, very few survived. And very few people know that that happened, and a few of us did. In Brazil, Mexico and the Caribbean, terrible things are happening. Hundreds of LGBT people are murdered every year or forced to commit suicide every year. 300 in Brazil last year alone. Have you heard about it? This poor soul, Itabali Lozano, was murdered by his mother and stepfather in December last year because he brought men home. Just makes my heart think about it. As most of you will know, in USA last year, 50 LGBT people were massacred in a nightclub terror attack by a Muslim extremist. Dozens more LGBT people in the US and the UK people died last year through bullying, murder and suicide. Do you hear about them? Right now, in Iraq, Libya and Syria, ISIS monsters are throwing suspected LGBT people from tall buildings. If they dare to survive, then small children are made to stone them to death. Right now, in Iran, gay and bisexual men are accepted by the government, but only if they have surgery to change their gender to normalise their relationships. If they refuse, they are dressed in new clothes to meet their vengeful god and hung in public like these two poor souls. Sorry to show you that image, but I think it just creates the impact on how awful this is and what's happening across the world. So why does it matter? Right now, being LGBT is a crime in 74 countries. Some of those are Commonwealth countries. In 13 countries, it's still punishable by death. There are hundreds of other such horrors across the world every year, decade after decade. The mainstream media rarely reports them. How aware of all these facts are you? So an LGBT faith matters very much indeed. So, LGBT people can try to find solace and recognition in the mainstream faiths, but they will struggle or have to hide their sexual orientation. Or they can seek out the existing faiths like mine about Titmus or the lovely Tuo Shen, the rabbit god in China. Or they can look at all those other gods and goddesses that I've described, and they, like we've done with Antinous, can start a faith anew and start worshipping those gods that were worshipped thousands of years ago and are still there. I believe the gods never go away. So you can sit down and make a link with those transgender gods or those lesbian gods or those bisexual gods if that's what's important to you, and you can recreate those faiths. Is there a need for a Glastonbury LGBT spiritual group? Maybe. I'll leave that to you. Have a chat with me over tea at the end. Tell me what you think. Finally, in the Antinous faith, we speak of homotheosis. My God exists in me, and I exist in him. We are one. Just as the famous gay artist Michelangelo Buonarroti showed us 500 years ago in this image. Thank you. Any questions? Contact the National Trust and suggest that we could do something. It's a good point. Yeah. Well, one of the things that you and I have been sort of pondering is whether I'm very happy as a priest to give blessings. And one of the things we've been pondering is perhaps me being somewhere in the town to offer blessings to people, maybe at the Market Cross. So we'll kind of ponder that, and if so, we'll kind of get that message out there.
I was just thinking. It was pointed out when Tegan mentioned the tour, how nice a place it would be, because there's such a lovely symbol.
Yes.
A phallic symbol. Sorry to be so crude, but it speaks volumes.
It does. Yeah, it's very male energy. Though.
Yes. Yeah. Although some people would have it as female energy with the two.
Which I think is perhaps more female.
Yeah,
that's an interesting thought. Yeah. Mm.
Thanks very much for the introductory section in particular, and for giving us such a clear presentation. When we heard your broadcast on Radio Somerset, we started talking at home about why there was all this prejudice, and of course, in broad terms, it's the Abrahamic religions, isn't it? Christianity and Islam, which are so dogmatic and confined in their perceptions. And of course, there are hundreds of reasons for that. If you look further afield, and you mentioned Hinduism, we lived in India for 2 years, and in India, it doesn't enter into the religious order. I mean, there isn't a God, and you can't talk about God as he, which recently has been offending me quite a lot because it might be either sex or no sex. And so again, the concept kind of isn't there. I mean, the gods and the female, the gods are male and female.
Yeah.
My only other comment, narrowing it down a bit, is I'm glad you mentioned Quakers. I'm not offering, this evening's attenders an alternative, but if you wanted Christianity without the prejudice, I think you would go to a meeting of the Society of Friends or Quakers. Mm-hmm. Quakers led in trying to redefine sexuality,
mm-hmm.
and I think you would find, because Quakers don't accept dogma, you would find that there isn't a dogmatic attitude, and everybody is seen as having God within them and on absolutely equal terms as they have been since the 17th century.
Totally agree, thank you. And the only thing I'd say about India, of course, is that whilst the people and the faith may be okay, the government's not. The government is and does legislate against homosexuality, which is seems at so much at odds with their culture.
Hindu nationalism. Yeah.
Yes.
Just trying to get a handle on Roman paganism. I mean, is there a way we can relate to that via our own pagan faiths, i.e. is it something that stems from a fundamental understanding and worship of Mother Earth, if you like, and nature?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, people often perceive the Roman and Greek cultures as having deities that all have all these specific roles, but they're also worshipped in terms of the cycle of the year, the wheel of the year, just as most other pagan faiths are. And some of the research I did was fascinating around some of the rising and setting of the sun at different points in the year. My hero Hadrian was very aware of that. He had an astronomy place where he studied the stars, built on his great in his great palace, the observatory, and he aligned temples and buildings with the rising and setting of the sun on the solstices and equinoxes and things like that. So he was very aware of the wheel of the year and followed those cycles. So I think there are parallels. I don't see that there should be any kind of barriers, but what I found sometimes is talking to British people, follows sort of more British paganism, that they don't kind of get that fit necessarily, and I struggle to describe it to make the fit sort of thing. So, but I think the parallels are there, and I think they could very happily exist side by side. I think both sides just need to explain it to each other and kind of find the ways of linking it together.
So what would followers of Valentinus now do then? Because there are lots of different pagan faiths, and you can go online and just Google, you know, we know what Wiccan people do, we know what the goddess temple do. So if people were wanting to investigate this further, what sort of thing can they expect in terms of personal practice?
In terms of the Antinous faith, it's quite difficult because it's international. So to try and do joint practice is a little tricky, but this is where modern technology helps. So a lot of it's done on Skype. So the main temple is in Los Angeles, and the pontifex of the faith is Antonio Subia, who founded the faith, and he holds ceremony in the Temple of Antinous in Los Angeles, which the whole world can zoom on and watch. There's a temple in Brazil which is very active, and in fact has the biggest membership across the world in Brazil. There are thousands of people following Antinous in Brazil. So they do actually have a physical temple, and they do worship in that temple. But again, Brazil is massive, so not everyone can be at that temple. So again, they do Skype ceremonies. Similarly, there is a group in Italy that I think does similar things. So in a way, because it's so international, you have to use modern technology to do it, and also there's Facebook pages and websites and all that sort of thing.
So is the kind of thing, is it like as if you were going to church on a Sunday, or can the actual practice be compared to anything that people who perhaps here tonight might be familiar with already, something that they can tap into and sort of walk away from here now and go, well, actually, maybe that might be a thing that would resonate with me, because there's more to it than just a gay god.
Or
a trans god. All of these things are important, but the wider picture is really important, isn't it, to faith and how it speaks. So I was wondering if you could tell us a bit about...
I mean, there is some kind of loose doctrine based on some of the early records and information we have about the early faith, which is quite small. And the Los Angeles Temple have kind of worked up a series of, I don't know how to describe it, kind of statements you make in front of a shrine that people will then follow and speak to, making offerings to the shrine. And people are encouraged to have shrines in their own home and to make their own relationship with Antinous and to make votive offerings or whatever they want to do. But it's an emerging faith. So it's something we go since 1995, I think it is.
It sounds to me like the practices are not tremendously outlandish. So it's something that people can investigate themselves. Absolutely. Easily, without having to learn lots of new skills, things like that.
There's nothing very structured, and it can be quite individual. I've been having conversations with the Los Angeles Temple because the founder is of Mexican origin, and therefore has been brought up through the Catholic Church. He's very into the drama and the dressing up and the swinging of the incense and all that sort of stuff. And I've been saying to him, "That's not going to sell in the UK." You know, if I was to wear a toga and, you know, wave some incense around, then it's not going to go down.
Nobody might, I'm a ceremonial magician, so yeah, bring on the rubbish.
It would work in places like Glastonbury. Yeah. I think if I was to, you know, roll up in Hoboken where I was born in a toga and say, "Here's a new faith," people are going to throw stones at me. You know, it's not going to happen. So you have to kind of find a middle ground, I think, where it will work. And I think that's what's happening all around the world. I mean, the Brazilian temple is fantastic because they sing and dance. You know, they've got that whole culture of the Mardi Gras.
Yeah.
So for them, it's colourful, it's singing, it's being loud. You know, so it will depend where you are in the world and, you know, what will work. You know, for me personally, it's a very quiet relationship between me and my God and me and my shrine. And you know, I look upon. And Sinus as my saviour, and I feel that my God, I'm him, he is me, and all I really need is that relationship with the shrine. I don't feel I need anything else. But if there are other worshippers around here, we would do something. We would have a shrine, we would make offerings, you know, we would do something. But I wouldn't see that the British version of it would be very dramatic, I don't think. But if people want to join in with me, we can make it up. You know,
well, what you're saying is it is very accessible, and the practices that you're identifying with the things that everybody's seen similar things before. Yeah. So it really means that people can actually engage with this. Because the problem is that when something emerges, sometimes it can be so outlandish that people are afraid to engage. Oh, yeah. So, you know, I was asking basically because people are going to go away and go and do that. Hang on, that resonates, and I can do that. And that's really fantastic because that makes it accessible to all the people who maybe find the other religions perhaps not so accessible. That's fabulous.
There's nothing strange about it. We don't dance naked or anything.
Well, that's not really good. You have to come to one of our rituals for that one.
It's just building a relationship with the gods sometimes through singing, sometimes through poetry, sometimes through some kind of written texts. Nothing formal, you know. I don't think it could be. I think, you know, for to be a gay faith, you know, people have been through trauma. They've been through all sorts of struggles with mainstream faiths that have clear doctrine that are telling them they're bad. So if we were to create a faith that was very doctrinaire and very telling you have to do this, this, and this, wouldn't work. And shouldn't
be. I was just wondering how accessible you think this is to younger people and the education system how it is today. And obviously, you're only just being guided into your priesthood and bringing your faith into a bigger world. But I feel like there's definitely a gap there that needs to be filled for the younger generation to be awakened. I don't know whether you've had any insights or anything, but, you know, if you see a vision ahead of you.
My vision is to try and get the word out. People talk about the good news of Christ. It's kind of the good news of Antinous, that it's kind of there is a faith for them. And I think the education system is tricky because it's... I see today, in fact, that sex education is now going to be formally pushed in every school. And the government has just announced that. So, you know, as part of those kind of discussions, you know, sex is not just about the physical, you know, it's about the emotional as well. and it could be about the spiritual, why not? So I would love to see that rolled out in the schools. I doubt it will happen, certainly under this government. But I think the more the people spread the word that there is a gay God, you know, that will filter out. The more people that kind of understand it, see it, know it. And the fact that the British Museum and the National Trust properties are going to do a big push on, you know, that a lot of them have got statues, images of, you know, famous gay people that have just been on the wall with no comment. You know, now suddenly they can come out and say, look, you know, our, the people that owned this house were gay, or this image they cooked on the wall was gay. You know. So that will start to get the word out. And I really hope that young people can be informed, get involved. Social media obviously is a fantastic way for them to find out. And, you know, on here, I've got my handouts, so I've got the Tennis Gable Facebook page and the website and so on. So that's one of the key ways, I think, is just say something out there, people find it.
Because I remember being just in religious education and there'd be sects, gods and goddesses and Hindu gods and things, but, you know, it would just be very limited. And so I feel like there could be, you know, much more of an awareness and lots of, just not religious education, spiritual education.
It would be really, really, really good. There'll be some schools, there'll be sort of science schools, and various other schools are probably would, but mainstream ones. Mm-hmm.
When you worship someone, you worship their beliefs. And Antinous was too young for you to know much about him, I suppose. Therefore, your religion, I feel that you are forming it, forming your doctrines. And I just wondered if I came to you, you know, as a priest, what you would say that you were believing in about how we live our lives, or whatever.
Mm-hmm. Well, if you look at the life of Antinous, although we don't know a great deal, we do know that the Emperor Hadrian, who was the most important man in the world other than the Emperor of China at the time, found something in Antinous that was very significant, very special. He, as the most powerful man, could have had anyone he wanted, and indeed probably did. But Antinous was the only one that he actually took as his consort and travelled the Roman Empire with. So there's something special about Antinous, and you can see every image of Antinous. He's not like all the other Romans you see that stare kind of angrily out at you. Antinous looks down away from you. So there's something deeply thoughtful about those images, and I think that's probably who Antinous was, a very gentle, thoughtful being. Hadrian then goes on to deify him, and I don't think he would have done that lightly. I think he would have felt that Antinous had sacrificed himself. So there you have one point in time where this young man has sacrificed himself, just like Jesus did, to say, you know, I'm sacrificing myself for my personal God, which for him was Hadrian, who of course hadn't been deified till he died, but as far as Antinous was concerned, Hadrian was his God, he would sacrifice himself for his God. And indeed, a few years before that, he had actually saved Hadrian from a charging lion, so he put himself continually in the face of danger to save his personal God. I'm trying to think how else to put it. Can't remember the way of putting it, but it's about being there for a community that is lost. And he was effectively saving a lost emperor and bringing back his empire. If he hadn't done that, the Roman Empire perhaps would have collapsed. A lot of the modern basis of the modern world would have collapsed. Who knows where we would be now? So that's another aspect of Antinous. So by building all those kind of pieces together, you kind of get a sense, sort of following a similar journey to Jesus along his kind of road to his ultimate sacrifice, that there's kind of been sacrifices and ways of looking at the world that are different. He clearly thought of the world differently. He is a god of Greece, Egypt, and Rome. So he brings all of those aspects as well. He brings Osiris from Egypt, he brings some of the wealth of the god from Greece, combines all of that. And it's up to us now to work on that faith, bring all of those things together and make something really positive that LGBT people can feel safe with, and anyone else. It's an important line to draw in the sand, because up until now, LGBT people have really struggled to find somewhere they can feel safe and sacred.
Yeah, I've just got an issue is that, although I think it's great that we're acknowledging these gay deities, particularly Antinous, are we not substituting heterosexual patriarchy for homosexual patriarchy? I mean, wouldn't it be better to have a more balance of the genders and have Sabina sort of incorporated somehow into this cult? Because, you know, otherwise we just find it all
sideways. I totally agree. And that's why I say the Antinous faith is not just for LGBT people, it's for people. But obviously, particularly helps LGBT people because they've never had a clear, identified gay god. You know, you don't have to, as I said earlier, I'm not a gay martyr. You know, I'm Martin, I've got the same I'm Martin. It's just, you don't have to say that Antinous is a gay god. He's being acknowledged as that way publicly just to get word out there, because how else is anybody going to check around and listen? But yeah, I totally agree. I would love to see all the mainstream faiths come opening their doors and saying, we love you, come on in, we don't judge you. Would be fantastic. It's slowly happening in some little bits of those mainstream faiths, but not much. And the pagan faiths, equally, or you know, as we were saying over here, you know, there's a range of faiths out there that are some welcome, some not, some could be, some are emerging. I would love to see them all welcome with everybody, of course. And I think, you know, when I say about Jesus, I think he could stand here and say exactly the same thing. And I think he would be genuinely angry at the way, and Muhammad, I think, would be angry at the way that Islam is being portrayed. All of those faiths came from a perspective of fighting patriarchy, fighting against the kind of the rules and the doctrines that were holding them down. They were about equality. And I think all faiths should be about equality, as is my faith, as I would hope all pagan faiths are as well. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, I think it just needs to be made a bit more obvious that, you know, because it's worshipping a male deity. And anyway, I mean, I have issues with worshipping any deity, really, because, like you started off talking about source, I feel we can go beyond a deity. I mean, it's good to identify, good to have these role models, positive role models of, you know, upstanding people who were elevated to the status of a god. But, you know, then going beyond, and you talked about the end as well, on a theistic approach, finding that God within ourselves. So, but anyway, I mean, it's an evolving process, I guess,
okay.
You can incorporate some more inclusive forms of celebration.
As I said earlier, my view of the gods and goddesses is that they are a conduit for us to that source. And the source is from which we will come. But I think we as human beings feel we need kind of a conduit to that. It's difficult to relate to a source. What is that? What does it look like? How does it feel? So having deities that have a human face, if you like, obviously, Antinous was a human, he was deified, he's now a god. So it's easier to relate to a face. You can kind of build that relationship a bit easier. But ultimately, I think you're right. I don't think it matters whether they're male, female, transgender, whatever they are. It really doesn't matter. And yes, of course, Antinous is a man, and of course that perpetuates some aspect of patriarchy. Wouldn't deny that. But he was a human man. So you can't easily get away from that aspect of it. He was created a deity. He is still a deity. People worshipped him. People still worship him. I'm not sure how you can get away from that, really.
There's a nice LGBT church in London. It's called House of Rainbow. I mean, I think it's more coming from a Christian perspective, but it's inclusive of all faiths and that's, a generic term which doesn't exclude and doesn't, it hasn't got an agenda label to it, which is nice.
Yeah, that's good.
That's all around.
Yeah, but ultimately it's about still worshipping their God, isn't it? So it's a really nice way of doing it, and I really acknowledge them. It's like the Quakers or the Unitarian Church. Brilliant. I really, really respect it. But at the end of the day, ultimately what they're wanting you to move towards is worshipping their God, which is great. I'm not doing that down at all. But still, at the end of the day, it is still part of that patriarchal system to an extent. It's very difficult, I think, for us to break out of that kind of system. I want us to, but I think it's difficult.
I think it's just worshipping ourselves, really. That's what it's more about.
Yeah, that's why I think homotheosis is really good, because it's saying that I'm God, God is me. And just that continuous cycle between, I think, is much more what we should be doing, rather than saying God's up there, and I acquiesce all my responsibility to that God up there to deliver my life. It's not that at all. We deliver our lives, we create our reality, we do so with the support and God's up there to help us to create our reality. That's what I see. Sorry. Okay.
It's kind of like an addendum to sort of add on to that bit of the discussion there. I reckon the hardest part is working with the ideologies that are underpinning things. This concept of the sort of gender binary, this polarity, and the fact that so it has to be male or it has to be female, or it has to be, therefore, to do the fertility dance, you have to have a male and a female because that's what's reflected, that's what people see. I think what's important about what you're saying tonight, and shouldn't maybe be underestimated, is it's actually pro-gay. So it's not a situation of, oh yes, well actually our underlying ideology is binary, male and female, and this is what it is, and that's what's right, but we'll put up with you and all of it. I think the point that I could see, and that, hat off there, is you stand there and you're going, actually, do you know what? We don't have to just be tolerating it, can't we just fit into that one? Actually, we can have a gay God, and there are plenty, actually.
Yeah.
And before we can go for complete equality across the board, people have to dare do that. People have to stand up and say, yeah, that God wears a dress. Yeah, that God's gay, that goddess is a lesbian, and that's fine. Because until that's fine and people can speak up about that, the equality thing's just, it feels like a bit of wallpapering over the top, because then people don't have to engage with the fact that actually some people feel uncomfortable about engaging with it. And so I think there's real value to be had in having this discourse shaking a little bit and this dialogue going on. So, I can't thank you enough for making it possible for us to all sort of look at that. Because that's important, because that's, while we're all trying to be as equal as possible, what it means is that, the underrepresented groups and people who do struggle, lesbians, gays, all of these underrepresented groups, while we're trying for equality, still don't actually get that much of a voice. And I think that's a really deep, fundamental issue that it's good to see that you're going to be doing something to rectify that as part of your faith. That's something I can really admire. And
I think the other thing I wanted to say is that all of those gods and goddesses were worshipped in their time.
Yeah.
So, you have very, very strong female goddesses, goddesses, etc. The patriarchal system swept that all away with the mainstream faith that we have now. And of course, they did that you worshipped that one god that they perceive as a male heterosexual god, and tell us that that's the god we have to worship. So it's swept away all of those things that I've been talking about, all of which are worshipped in very good faith, just as they are in India. People were just open. And what happened 2,000, 3,000 years ago is all of that openness was swept away. And I guess what we're trying to do, and we have to do it, I guess, by saying that's a male gay god, that's a lesbian, that's a trans god, is just putting them back on the map, because they were just wiped away.
Yeah. It's just redressed in the times.
Yeah.
If I could just clarify about Quakers, because they, many are non-theists. Men don't, many Quakers don't believe in a god.
Yeah.
And it's like you were saying about the Rainbow Cafe, it's just the same. Everybody is welcome.
Is it a Quaker? Is it a Quaker organisation? The Rainbow.
I think it's by this Nigerian guy, and they're particularly ostracised in his country.
They are totally.
Basically,
yeah, I've heard of it, and it sounds just the same.
Yeah, he's sort of signed here, but he still wants a place to worship. Because he can do it, I can understand that. So,
So it doesn't fit with all the Christian religions who are saying. Jesus died for our faith. You know, it's different.
Yeah.
It just accepts everyone, but has its main truths: peace, in justice, and love.
Any other questions? Thank you all very much.
I've got a suggestion.
Yeah.
Maybe you could have your church out in the open, and have it at the Avalon Orchard. You can access it by going diagonally across the field when you go to the tour path at the top. And you can see the tour above you from the orchard.
Yeah,
so it's a rather nice seasonal place to have it.
There's also
and to be out in the open.
Sorry to interrupt, I'm just saying there is another group that meets there. It's a Druid group. Which I go along to, and we meet at various times of the year. And so, make it one big happy family, I would say. The more the merrier.
Yeah. Thank you all very much for listening, we really appreciate it.
Bringing this discussion here and for everybody's fantastic questions and involvement, because it is really, really important to discuss these things in Glastonbury, in Somerset, and everywhere. And for, you know, there were many things in the history that you read through, incredibly moving, that I didn't know. I've known the Pink Triangle, I've been on gay pride marches, and yet I didn't know where that had originated from. And you know, just those histories. It really has made such a difference now to me that I know what that means. So, yeah, thank you. And for your own story and for sharing that, thank you. I want to say, what I feel about Anthony Lewis is when one looks at him, I just feel it. What comes through is the purity. It's like a purity and an innocence. When you see, when you come across people who really are on a very pure place, that's what comes through in the statues, and I wonder if, in many ways, that is what is attracting people is that. It's beautiful. So we shall have tea, and you can have one-to-one and more discussion, and come have a look at the book. When Martin and I first met in the cafe to talk about things, he brought this book, and it is worth looking through. It's got each chapter, it's got the most brilliant title to it, so... Please have a look. As a really, really lovely gift to us all, Martin has spent a lot of time and he has made these little booklets to take away that sums up the evening tonight. And there are loads of gorgeous pictures of the various gods and goddesses in. And they're in a pile over there, so please take one each if you'd like them. And if there are any left over, once everyone has some, you're welcome to take them for friends as well. So, yeah, thank you for this. Quickly, next week, conscious dreamer of the Mayan wave spell, Joe Kenworthy. The Mayan wave spell is a powerful...
Yeah, goddesses. The goddess Atalgatis. She is a female deity worshipped in what is now Aleppo in Syria. So, sadly, a lot of the archaeology there is not gone. And during the Roman era, the young males castrated themselves to become transgender deities at the temple, thereafter performing temple tasks traditionally done by women in the temple. Thus, a goddess worshipped by trans people. The Egyptian deity Hapi, great name, was the god of the annual flooding of the River Nile, fish, birds, and lord of the river bringing vegetation. It was the goddess that was worshipped every year. The Nile became inundated with water, and they would measure the height of the Nile every year with the goddess or god Hapi standing there. Hapi is depicted as a transgender deity with a large belly, pendulous breasts, and wearing a loincloth and a ceremonial false beard of the pharaohs. So, transgender deity. There are gender fluid Hindu deities. Many of the Hindu deities do kind of flow between different genders. So there's Adana Haravisara, who was created by the merging of Shiva and Parvati. And the name means the Lord who is half a woman. The god Vishnu took the form of the enchantress Mohini to trick the demons into giving up the elixir of life, wouldn't we all like that? Thus, transgender deities. And the gods El-gabal and El-gabalus. In the ancient city called Emesa, now tragically Homs in modern Syria, virtually destroyed in the recent conflict, there was a cult to a genderless deity called El-gabal. The main temple was built around a large stone, probably, we think, a meteorite. There was a Roman emperor called Marcus Aurelius Antoninus. He was born in Emesa. And when he became emperor as a teenager, a very young teenager, he renamed himself El-gabalus. And he had himself castrated so that he could better emulate his god to be a genderless god. And he lived then and dressed as a woman. So he was a transgender emperor and the incarnation of a god. So a trans god. Any of you heard? So why does all this matter? Well, in recorded history, we know for the last 700 years, at least, that's kind of what we know is recorded for 700 years, LGBT people have been deliberately and specifically persecuted for being themselves. Hundreds, possibly thousands of sodomites or buggers were burned at the stake in the Middle Ages. Homosexuality was a Hannibal offence in most European countries until the late 1800s. In the 1930s, Germany, the Nazis arrested approximately 100,000 men and forced them to wear a big triangle, as I wear very proudly. Roughly 50,000 of those men were officially sentenced. Most of them spent their time in ordinary prisons, but 15,000 poor souls were incarcerated in the Nazi concentration camps, and very, very few survived. And very few people know that happened. A few questions. Yeah. In Brazil, Mexico, and the Caribbean, terrible things are happening. Hundreds of LGBT people are murdered every year or forced to commit suicide every year. 300 in Brazil last year alone. Any of you heard about it? This poor soul, Ita Bali Lozano, was murdered by his mother and stepfather in December last year because he brought men home. Just makes my heart think about it. As most of you will know, in USA last year, 50 LGBT people were massacred in a nightclub terror attack by a Muslim extremist. Dozens more LGBT people in the US and the UK people died last year through bullying, murder and suicide. Do you hear about them? Right now, in Iraq, Libya and Syria, ISIS monsters are throwing suspected LGBT people from tall buildings. If they dare to survive, then small children are made to stone them to death. Right now, in Iran, gay and bisexual men are accepted by the government, but only if they have surgery to change their gender to normalise their relationships. If they refuse, the They are dressed in new clothes to meet their vengeful god and hung in public like these two poor, poor souls. Sorry to show you that image, but I think it just creates the impact on how awful this is and what's happening across the world. So why does it matter? Right now, being LGBT is a crime in 74 countries. Some of those are Commonwealth countries. In 13 countries, it's still punishable by death. There are hundreds of other such horrors across the world every year, decade after decade. The mainstream media rarely reports them. How aware of all these facts are you? So an LGBT faith matters very much indeed. So, LGBT people can try to find solace and recognition in the mainstream faiths, but they will struggle or have to hide their sexual orientation. Or they can seek out the existing faiths like mine of Actinus or the lovely Tuo Shen, the rabbit god in China. Or they can look at all those other gods and goddesses that I've described, and they, like we've done with Antinous, can start a faith anew and start worshipping those gods that were worshipped thousands of years ago and are still there. I believe the gods never go away. So you can sit down and make a link with those transgender gods or those lesbian gods or those bisexual gods if that's what's important to you, and you can recreate those faiths. Is there a need for a Glastonbury LGBT spiritual group? Maybe. I'll leave that to you. Have a chat with me over tea at the end. Tell me what you think. Finally, in the Antinous faith, we speak of homotheosis. My God exists in me, and I exist in him. We are one. Just as the famous gay artist Michelangelo Buonarroti showed us 500 years ago in this image. Thank you. Any questions? Contact the National Trust and suggest that we could do something. It's a good point. Yeah. Well, one of the things that you and I have been sort of pondering is whether, you know, I'm very happy as a priest to give lessons. And one of the things we've been pondering is perhaps me being somewhere in the town to offer blessings to people, maybe at the Market Cross. So we'll kind of ponder that, and if so, we'll kind of get that message out there.
I was just thinking. It was pointed out when Tegan mentioned the tour, how nice the place it would be, because there's such a lovely symbol.
Yes.
A phallic symbol. Sorry to be so crude, but it speaks volumes.
It does. Yeah, it's very male energy.
Yes. Yeah. Although some people would have it as female energy with the two.
Yeah, you've got Charles,
that's another
story. Which I think is perhaps more female, isn't it? Yeah, that's an interesting
point. Thanks very much for the introductory section in particular, and for giving us such a clear presentation. When we heard your broadcast on Radio Somerset, we started talking at home about why there was all this prejudice, and of course, in broad terms, it's the Abrahamic religions, isn't it? Christianity and Islam, which are so dogmatic and confined in their perceptions. And of course, there are hundreds of reasons for that. If you look further afield, and you mentioned Hinduism, we lived in India for 2 years, and in India, it doesn't enter into the religious order. I mean, there isn't a God, and you can't talk about God as he, which recently has been offending me quite a lot because it might be either sex or no sex. And so again, the concept kind of isn't there. I mean, the gods and the female, the gods are male and female.
Yeah.
My only other comment, narrowing it down a bit, is I'm glad you mentioned Quakers. I'm not offering this evening's attenders an alternative, but if you wanted Christianity without the prejudice, I think you would go to a meeting of the Society of Friends or Quakers.
Mm-hmm.
Quakers led in trying to redefine sexuality,
mm-hmm.
and I think you would find, because Quakers don't accept dogma, you would find that there isn't a dogmatic attitude, and everybody is seen as having God within them and on absolutely equal terms as they have been since the 16th, 17th century.
Totally agree, thank you. And the only thing I'd say about India, of course, is that whilst the people and the faith may be okay, the government's not. the government is and does legislate against homosexuality, which is seems at so sort of odds with their culture.
Hindu nationalism. Yeah.
Just trying to get a handle on Roman paganism. I mean, is there a way we can relate to that via our own pagan faiths, i.e. is it something that stems from a fundamental understanding and worship of Mother Earth, if you like, and nature?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, people often perceive the Roman and Greek cultures as having deities that all have all these specific roles, but they're also worshipped in terms of the cycle of the year, the wheel of the year, just as most other pagan faiths are. Some of the research I did was fascinating around some of the rising and setting of the sun at different points in the year. My hero Hadrian was very aware of that. He had an astronomy place where he studied the stars, built on his great palace, the observatory, and he aligned temples and buildings with the rising and setting of the sun on the solstices and equinoxes and things like that. So he was very aware of the wheel of the year and followed those cycles. So I think there are parallels. I don't see that there should be any kind of barriers, but what I found sometimes is talking to British people, for sort of more British paganism, that they don't kind of get that fit necessarily, and I struggle to describe it to make the fit sort of thing. So, but I think the parallels are there, and I think they could very happily exist side by side. I think both sides just need to explain to each other and kind of find the ways of linking it together.
So what would followers of Valentinus now do then? Because there are lots of different pagan faiths, and you can go online and just Google, you know, we know what the wicked people do, we know what the goddess temple do. So if people were wanting to investigate this further, what sort of thing can they expect in terms of personal practice?
In terms of the Valentinus faith, it's quite difficult because it's international. So to try and do joint practice is a little tricky, but this is where modern technology helps. So a lot of it's done on Skype. So the main temple is in Los Angeles, and the pontifex of the faith is Antonio Subia, who founded the faith. And he holds ceremony in the Temple of Antinous in Los Angeles, which the whole world can zoom in on and watch. There's a temple in Brazil which is very active, and in fact has the biggest membership across the world in Brazil. There are thousands of people following Antinous in Brazil. So they do actually have a physical temple, and they do worship in that temple. But again, Brazil is massive, so not everyone can be at that temple. So again, they do Skype ceremonies. Similarly, there is a group in Italy that I think does similar things. So in a way, because it's so international, you have to use modern technology to do it, and also there's Facebook pages and websites and all that sort of thing.
So is the kind of thing, is it like as if you were going to church on a Sunday, or can the actual practice be compared to anything that people who perhaps see it tonight might be familiar with already, something that they can tap into and sort of walk away from here and now go, well, actually, maybe that might be a thing that would resonate with me, because there's more to it than just a gay god.
Or
a trans god. All of these things are important, but the wider picture is really important, isn't it, to faith and how it speaks. So I was wondering if you could tell us a bit about...
I mean, there is some kind of loose doctrine based on some of the early records and information we have about the early faith, which is quite small. And the Los Angeles Temple have kind of worked up a series of, statements you make in front of a shrine that people will then follow and speak to, making offerings to the shrine. And people are encouraged to have shrines in their own home and to make their own relationship with Antinous and to make votive offerings or whatever they want to do. But it's an emerging faith. So it's something we go since 1995, I think it is.
It sounds to me like the practices are not tremendously outlandish. So it's something that people can investigate themselves easily without having to learn lots of new skills and things like that.
There's nothing very structured, and it can be quite individual. I've been having conversations with the Los Angeles Temple because the founder is of Mexican origin, and therefore has been brought up through the Catholic Church. He's very into the drama and the dressing up and the swinging of the incense and that sort of stuff. And I've been saying to him, that's not going to sell in the UK. If I was to wear a toga and wave some incense around, it's not going to go down.
But it might. I'm a ceremonial magician, so bring on the rope.
It would work in places like Glastonbury. Yeah. I think if I was to roll up in Hoboken and where I was born in a toga and say, here's a new faith, people are going to throw stones at me. It's not that. So you have to kind of find a middle ground, I think, where it will work. And I think that's what's happening all around the world. The Brazilian temple is fantastic because they sing and dance. They've got that whole culture of the Mardi Gras.
Yeah.
So for them, it's colourful, it's singing, it's being loud. So it will depend where you are in the world and what will work. For me personally, it's a very quiet relationship between me and my God and me and my shrine. I look upon Antinous as my saviour, and I feel that my God, I'm him, he is me, and all I really need is that relationship with the shrine. I don't feel I need anything else. But if there are other worshippers around me here, we would do something. We would have a shrine, we would make offerings, we would do something. But I wouldn't see that the British version of it would be very dramatic, I don't think. But if people want to join in with me, we can make it up.
Well, what you're saying is it is very accessible, and practices that you're identifying with are things that everybody's seen similar things before. Yeah. So it really means that people can actually engage with this. Because the problem is that when something emerges, sometimes it can be so outlandish that people are afraid to engage. I was asking basically because people are going to go away and go, I can do that. Hang on, that resonates, and I can do that. And that's really fantastic because that makes it accessible to all people who maybe find the other religions perhaps not so accessible. Yeah. That's fabulous. Yeah,
there's nothing strange about it. We don't dance naked or anything.
Well, that's not very good. You have to come to one of our rituals for that one.
It's just building a relationship with the gods. Sometimes through singing, sometimes through poetry, sometimes through some kind of written texts. Nothing formal, I don't think it could be. I think, for to be a gay faith, people have been through trauma, they've been through all sorts of struggles with mainstream faiths that have clear doctrine that are telling them they're bad. So if we were to create a faith that was very doctrinaire and very telling you have to do this, this, and this, wouldn't work and shouldn't be like that.
I was just wondering how accessible do you think this is to younger people and the education system, how it is today? And obviously you're only just being guided into priesthood and bringing your faith into the bigger world, but I feel like there's definitely a gap there that needs to be filled, that the younger generation to be awakened. I don't know when you had any insight sort of thing, but you know, if you see a vision ahead of you?
My vision is to try and get the word out. People talk about the good news of Christ, it's kind of the good news of Pontemus, that it's kind of there is a faith for them. And I think the education system is tricky because it's... I see today, in fact, that sex education is now going to be formally pushed in every school. The government has just announced that. So, as part of those kind of discussions, sex is not just about the physical, it's about the emotional as well. And it could be about the spiritual, why not? So, I would love to see that rolled out in the schools. I doubt it will happen, certainly under this government. But I think the more the people spread the word that there is a great God, that will filter out. The more people that kind of understand it, see it, know it. The fact that the British Museum and the National Trust properties are going to do a big push on, a lot of them have got statues, images of famous gay people that have just been on the wall with no comment. Now suddenly they can come out and say, look, the people that owned this house were gay, or this image they clipped on the wall was gay. So that will start to get the word out. And I really hope that young people can be informed, get involved. Social media obviously is a fantastic way to find out. On here I've got my handouts, I've got the Tennis the Gay Book Facebook page and the website and so on. So that's one of the key ways, I think, is just say something out there, people can find it.
Because I remember being just in religious education and there'd be sex gods and goddesses and Hindu gods and things, but it would just be very limited. So I feel like there could be, much more of an awareness and lots of just not religious education, spiritual education.
There'll be some schools, science schools, and various other schools are probably will, mainstream ones.
When you worship someone, you worship their beliefs, and Antinous was too young for you to know much about him, I suppose. Therefore, your religion, I feel that you are forming it, forming your doctrines. And I just wondered if I came to you, as a priest, what you would say that you were believing in about how we live our lives, or whatever.
Mm-hmm. Well, if you look at the life of Antinous, although we don't know a great deal, we do know that the Emperor Hadrian, who was the most important man in the world other than the Emperor of China at the time, found something in Antinous that was very significant, very special. He, as the most powerful man, could have had anyone he wanted, and indeed probably did. But Antinous was the only one that he actually took as his consort and travelled the Roman Empire with. So there's something special about Antinous, and you can see every image of Antinous. He's not like all the other Romans you see that stare kind of angrily out at you. Antinous looks down away from you. So there's something deeply thoughtful about those images, and I think that's probably who Antinous was, a very gentle, thoughtful being. Hadrian then goes on to deify him. And I don't think he would have done that lightly. I think he would have felt that Antinous had sacrificed himself. So there you have one point in time where this young man has sacrificed himself, just like Jesus did, to say, I'm sacrificing myself for my personal God, which for him was Hadrian, who of course hadn't been deified till he died. But as far as Antinous was concerned, Hadrian was his God. He would sacrifice himself for his God. And indeed, a few years before that, he had actually saved Hadrian from a charging lion. So he put himself continually in in the face of danger to save his personal god. I'm trying to think how else to put it. Can't remember the way of putting it, but it's about being there for a community that is lost. And he was effectively saving a lost emperor and bringing back his empire. If he hadn't done that, the Roman Empire perhaps would have collapsed. A lot of the modern basis of the modern world would have collapsed. Who knows where we would be now? So that's another aspect of antithesis. So by building all those kind of pieces together, you kind of get a sense, sort of following a similar journey to Jesus along his kind of road to his ultimate sacrifice, that there's kind of been sacrifices and ways of looking at the world that are different. He clearly thought of the world differently. He is a god of Greece, Egypt and Rome. So he brings all of those aspects as well. He brings Osiris from Egypt, he brings some of the wealth of the gods from Greece, combines all of that. And it's up to us now to work on our faith, bring all of those things together and make something really positive that LGBT people can feel safe with, and anyone else. It's an important line to draw in the sand, because up until now, LGBT people have really struggled to find somewhere they can feel safe and sacred.
I've just got an issue is that, although I think it's great that we're acknowledging these gay deities, particularly Antinous, are we not substituting heterosexual patriarchy for homosexual patriarchy? I mean, wouldn't it be better to have a more balance of the genders and have Sabina to be incorporated somehow into this cult? Because, you know, otherwise we just fond it all
I totally agree. And that's why I say the Antinous faith is not just for LGBT people, it's for people. But obviously it particularly helps LGBT people because they've never had a clear, identified gay book. You know, you don't have to, as I said earlier, I'm not a gay Martin. You know, I'm Martin, I've got the same as Martin. It's just, you don't have to say that Antinous is a gay god. He's being acknowledged as that way publicly just to get word out there, because how else is anybody going to turn around and listen? But yeah, I totally agree. I would love to see all the mainstream faiths kind of opening their doors and saying, we love you, come on in, we don't judge you. Would be fantastic. It's slowly happening in some little bits of those mainstream faiths, but not much. And the pagan faiths equally, or you know, it's the same way again to you. Yeah, there's a range of faiths out there that are some welcome, some not, some could be, some are emerging. I would love to see them all welcome with everybody, of course. And I think, you know, when I say about Jesus, I think he would stand here and say exactly the same thing. And I think he would be genuinely angry at the way, and Muhammad, I think, would be angry at the way that Islam is being portrayed. All of those faiths came from a perspective of fighting patriarchy, fighting against the kind of the rules and the doctrines that were holding them down. They were about equality. And I think all faiths should be about equality, as is my faith, as I would hope all pagan faiths are as well. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, I think it just needs to be made a bit more obvious that, you know, because it's worshipping a male deity. And anyway, I mean, I have issues with worshipping any deity, really. Because, like you started off talking about source, I feel we can go beyond a deity. I mean, it's good to identify, good to have these role models, positive role models of, you know, upstanding people who are elevated to the status of a god. But, you know, then go beyond. And you talked about the end as well, on a theistic approach, finding that. God within ourselves. So, but anyway, I mean, it's an evolving process, I guess,
exactly.
That can incorporate some more inclusive forms of celebration.
Yeah. As I said earlier, my view of the gods and goddesses is that they are a conduit for us to that source, and the source is from which we all come. But I think we as human beings feel we need kind of a conduit to that. It's difficult to relate to a source. What is that? What does it look like? How does it feel? So having a deities that have a human face, if you like, obviously, and Timus was a human, he was deified, he was now a god. So it's easier to relate to a face. You can kind of build that relationship a bit easier. But ultimately, I think you're right. I don't think it matters whether they're male, female, transgender, whatever they are. It really doesn't matter. And yes, of course, Timus is a man, and of course that perpetuates some aspects of patriarchy. Wouldn't deny that. But he was a human man, so you can't easily get away from that aspect of him. He was created a deity, he is still a deity, people worshipped him, people still worship him. I'm not sure how you can get away from that, really.
There's a nice LGBT church in London, it's called House of Rainbow. I mean, I think it's more coming from a Christian perspective, but it's inclusive of all faiths, and they, you know, that's, you know, a generic term which doesn't exclude and doesn't, you know, it hasn't got a gender label to it, which is nice.
Yeah, that's good.
That's all we round.
Yeah, I understand it. But ultimately it's about still worshipping their God, isn't it? So it's a really nice way of doing it, and I really acknowledge it. It's like a Quaker sort of Unitarian church. Brilliant. I really, really respect it. But at the end of the day, ultimately, what they're wanting you to move towards is worshipping their God, which is great. I'm not doing that down at all. But still, at the end of the day, it is still part of that patriarchal system to an extent. So it's very difficult, I think, for us to break out of that kind of system. I want us to, but I think it's difficult.
I think it's just worshipping ourselves, really.
Yeah, yeah, that's why I think homotheosis is really good, because it's saying that I am God, God is me, and just that continuous cycle between, I think, is much more what we should be doing, rather than saying God's up there and I acquiesce all my responsibility to that God up there to deliver my life. It's not that at all. We deliver our lives, we create our reality, we do so with the support and you know, gods are there to help us to create our world. That's what I see. Sorry. Okay.
It's kind of like an addendum to sort of add on to that bit of the discussion there. I reckon the hardest part is working with the ideologies that are underpinning things. This concept of the sort of gender binary, this polarity, and the fact that, so it has to be male, or it has to be female, or it has to be, you know, therefore, to do the fertility dance, you have to have a male and a female, because that's what's reflected, that's what people see. I think what's important about what you're saying tonight, and shouldn't maybe be underestimated, is it's actually pro-gay. So it's not a situation of, oh yes, well actually, our underlying ideology is binary, male and female, and this is what it is, and that's what's right. But we'll put up with you and all of it. I think the point that I can see, and that, you know, hat off there, is you stand there and you're going, actually, do you know what? We don't have to just be tolerating it, can't we just fit into that one? Actually, we can have a gay God, and there are plenty, actually.
Yeah.
And before we can go for complete equality across the board, people have to dare do that. People have to stand up and say, yeah, that God wears a dress. Yeah, that God's gay, that goddess is a lesbian, and that's fine, because until that's fine and people can speak up about that, the equality thing's just, it feels like a bit of wallpapering over the top, because then people don't have to engage with the fact that actually some people feel uncomfortable about engaging with it. And so I think there's real value to be had in having this discourse shaping a little bit and this dialogue going on. So, you know, I can't thank you enough for making it possible for us to all sort of look at that. Because that's important, because that's, while we're all trying to be as equal as possible, what it means is that, you know, the underrepresented groups and people who do struggle, you know, lesbians, gays, all of these underrepresented groups, while we're trying for equality, still don't actually get that much of a voice. And I think that's a really deep, fundamental issue that it's good to see that you're going to be doing something to rectify that as part of your faith. That's something I can really admire.
I think the other thing I wanted to say is that all of those gods and goddesses were worshipped in their time.
Yeah.
So, you know, you have very, very strong female goddesses, goddesses, etc. The patriarchal system swept that all away with the, sort of the mainstream faith that we have now. And of course, immediately you worship that one god that they perceive as a male heterosexual god and tell us that that's the god we have to worship. So it swept away all of those things that I've been talking about, all of which are worshipped in very good faith, just as they are in India. You know, people were just open. And what happened 2,000, 3,000 years ago is all of that openness was swept away. And I guess what we're trying to do, and we have to do it, I guess, by saying that's a male gay god, that's a lesbian, that's a trans god, is just putting them back on the map, because they were just wiped away.
It's just features in the times.
Yeah.
If I could just clarify about Quakers, because they, many are non-theists. Men don't, many Quakers don't believe in a god.
Yeah.
And it's like you were saying about the Rainbow Cafe, it's just the same. Everybody is welcome.
Is it a Quaker organisation? The Rainbow?
I think it's by this Nigerian guy, and they're particularly ostracised in his country.
I've heard of this, and it sounds just the same.
Yeah, he's sort of assigned here, but he still wants a place to worship, because he can do it back in his homeland. So,
So it doesn't fit with all the Christian religions who are saying Jesus died for our faith. You know, it's different. Yeah. Just accept everyone, but has its main truths: peace, in justice, and love.
Any other questions? Thank you all very much.
I've got a suggestion.
Yeah.
Maybe you could have your church out in the open and have it at the Avalon Orchard. You can access it by going diagonally across the field when you go to the tour path at the top. And you can see the tour above you from the orchard.
Yeah,
it's a rather nice seasonal place to have it.
There's also
and be out in the open.
Sorry to interrupt, I'm just saying there is another group that meets there. It's a Druid group, which I go along to.
Uh-huh.
And we meet at various times of the year. So make it one big happy family, I would say. The more the merrier.
Thank you all very much for listening. We really appreciate it.
Questions and involvement, because it is really, really important to discuss these things in Glastonbury, in Somerset, and everywhere. And there were many things in the history that you read through, incredibly moving, that I didn't know. I've known the Pink Triangle, I've been on gay pride marches, and yet I didn't know where that had originated from. And just those histories. It really is. Made such a difference now to me that I know what that means. So, yeah, thank you. And for your own story and for sharing that, thank you. I want to say, what I feel about Antinous is when one looks at him, I just feel it. What comes through is the purity, is like a purity and an innocence. When you see, when you come across people who really are in a very pure place, that's what comes through in the statues, and I wonder if, in many ways, that is what is attracting people. Is that? It's beautiful. So we shall have tea, and you can have one-to-one and more discussion, and come have a look at the book. When Martin and I first met in the cafe to talk about things, he brought this book, and it is worth looking through. It's got each chapter. It's got the most brilliant title to it. So please have a look. As a really, really lovely gift to us all. Martin has spent a lot of time and he has made little booklets to take away that sums up the evening tonight, and there are loads of gorgeous pictures of the various gods and goddesses in, and they're in a pile over there, so please take one each if you'd like them, and if there are any left over once everyone has some, you're welcome to take them for friends as well. So yeah, thank you for this. Quickly, next week, conscious dreamer of the Mayan wave spell, Joe Kenworthy. The Mayan wave spell is a powerful